My name is Kevin Kern. I am the Regional Archives Manager for the Walt Disney Archives. It is an honor to be here today to help introduce this show. Who here loves the one, the only, the original Country Bear Musical Jamboree? And in fact, I'm going to turn it over to two of my friends. I've got my pal Stephen Bagney from the Walt Disney Archives. Woo!
Well, howdy, folks!
Howdy!
I always wanted to do that. How's everyone this evening?
Great!
All right, well, welcome to Grizzly Hall with the one and only original Country Bear musical chamber. Well, thank you so much. Who is a fan of the Country Bears? By a show of hands.
Woo! All right.
Clapping and stomping. This is wonderful. Well, thank you so much. As Kevin mentioned, I'm Stephen from the Walt Disney Archives, and Ken Ritchie from Walt Disney Imagineering. Ken was actually my leader when I was at WDI for about 5 years or so. So I am so thrilled for you to hear from Ken directly as the producer of the spectacular show that you're all about to see. So thank you so much for being here. And Ken, why don't we start off a little bit by sharing your background with Disney and what brought you to be producer of this great show?
I have been a Disney fan my entire life. I grew up in the 70s and 80s watching the wonderful world of Disney movies. I knew when I was in high school and I saw Mickey Mouse standing on Spaceship Earth that I had to be an Imagineer. And I didn't give up until I made that dream a reality in 2002 when I started working as a mechanical engineer for Walt Disney World. And then transitioned to Imagineering in 2013 as the manager of technical show quality for the Walt Disney World Resort under Imagineering. One of my roles as that manager of technical show quality is to lead the refurbishment of our audio animatronics across the property. And I've done a number of projects with that, and the Bears, I had been pushing for the Bears to be refurbished before COVID. And then we heard this project was coming, and so wanted to align that refurbishment with the project. And then I went to the leader, and I'm very passionate about the Bears, and a huge fan of Mark Davis and Exitensio. And I was like, can I please produce the show? So, and that's how I ended up as the show producer.
In the right place at the right time. All right, the right cast of Bears here. All right, well, so one thing that we'd like to do is share a little bit of the history and heritage of the Country Bears themselves, and then really dig in and talk about the nitty-gritty about the show. So if you'll indulge me for just a moment, I want to share a little bit about background that goes back to Walt Disney himself. Now, some of you may be aware that the Country Bears weren't originally intended to be part of the Magic Kingdom. In fact, they were initially conceived for another Disney project. Does anyone here know what that project might have been?
Ski Resort.
Yeah, Disney was the mid-late 1960s looking at potentially creating a ski resort in the Mineral King Valley in California. And for a variety of reasons, it never actually materialized. But this, you know, year-round resort with skiing and fishing and just, you know, enjoying the great outdoors, if you will, Walt envisioned a, you know, maybe 30 to 50 acre alpine-style village. And then there would have been entertainment, lodging, some entertainment. And with that, Walt had an idea for a bear band. These bears that came out of the woods that Disney taught to be entertainers. And from that small idea that Walt had, he brought it to one of his top Imagineers, Mark Davis, who you just mentioned. Mark had a long history with animation prior to joining the Imagineering team. If you know characters like Cruella de Vil, Maleficent, Tinkerbell, mm-hmm. those are ones that Mark really brought to life through his animation style. And you know, what a perfect skill to bring to three dimension, right? You know, from the subtlety to the extravagant theatrical performances, Mark really had the breath to create convincing personality animation. So Walt said, why don't you go ahead and work on this bear band concept? Fast forward to maybe November of 1966, and Walt Disney makes a very special visit to Walt Disney Imagineering, then known as Wet Enterprises, if you weren't aware of that. And Walt had been in and out of the hospital at the time, and he was very eager to see the status of one of these projects at the studio and at Wet. Mark shows him these bear sketches as part of that visit. And Walt's looking at this small bear with a big tuba and all these other amazing little sketches of instruments of all kinds and bears of all kinds, and we'll talk about that bear with the tuba later. And Walt let out the biggest laugh that Mark had heard in quite a while. And about 4 weeks later, we lost Walt Disney. So we go back to that time and we really consider that moment to be Walt's last laugh, as it's known, is the idea for what would become the Country Bear Jamboree. So how great that show continues to live on. It was decided that Magic Kingdom here at Walt Disney World would be the best place for it, because, as we mentioned, Mineral Kingdom did not move forward. But we were then looking at, well, what can we do to bring some new attractions to this new park that we're working on for Florida? And what better place than Frontierland for these singing bears? And originally, it wasn't going to be a show inside Grizzly Hall here. It was actually going to be what was then known as the Bear Band Restaurant, an outdoor venue in which these waterfalls would act as curtains. And the curtains of water would open, you'd see a bear perform, it would close, that stage would rotate for the next act. For a variety of reasons, they brought that concept indoors. I wonder why.
Bear conditioning.
We're previewing the show that we're about to see, I think, with the bear bugs.
Over a year, bear hugs.
So anyway, the Grizzly Hall concept then materialized with this beautiful Dorothea Redmond-inspired interior that we see here. We're an opening day attraction, October 1st, 1971, one of only three attractions in the park that was totally unique to the Magic Kingdom when we opened, the rest having sort of iterations that premiered at Disneyland. Does anyone know the other two attractions that were original to the park completely?
Mickey Mouse Review.
Mickey Mouse Review,
for those of you who know.
Is that John? Hey, John, how are you? Biggest Mickey Mouse Review fan in the world. I knew it was you from the attraction. Hall of Presidents is the other, absolutely. So, Country Bear Jamboree.
But does he know the three cabs in Mexico? My team took those from Tokyo and put them back in Mexico, and they were from the original Mickey Mouse Review.
He's a cast member, so. Very knowledgeable. Any trivia, John? You want to go up here in terms of trivia? You're a paying guest. So with that, very excited. 50 years later, the Country Bears, 50 plus years later, they're still here and singing brand new songs. And, you know, Ken, you mentioned how much you love the show, how much you want to be part of this. What do you think is so special about the Country Bears that lets them endure and entertain so many years later?
For me, it's the Country Bears being a classic, having Mark Davis and Exotencio involved. It felt to me, it's always felt like an immersive cartoon. Like I was living out Saturday morning cartoons with the hokiness and the banter and the laughs, and that's what resonated most with me with the show.
Kind of a three-dimensional version of that entertainment, right? And it goes right back to the whole idea of the illusion of life. And Walt said with audio animatronics figures, it's just another way that we tell stories through animation. But Ken, you know, when you work on a show like Country Bears, it has such a huge fan base. Yes? Yeah. And so there's absolutely no pressure at all on you to do it right, right?
I felt a Louisa. There's a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
Immense pressure.
Tell us about it. What approach do you take?
So we definitely want to stay true to the original creative intent that Mark had, and we wanted to stay true to the story arc, and we wanted a connection to the prior show, but we needed to resonate with a much larger audience. If the Bears are to continue on for 50 years, and I hope they do, we needed to fill this theater. And how do we do that? We want to resonate with the older generation, but we want to connect with the newer generation, and that was the goal, threading a needle with, you know, some new original songs, some authentic country songs, but with lyrics that connect to everyone, that remind them of their childhood with Disney growing up, that they in turn can bring in their children and connect with them. And then closing with an original song remastered that was our goal.
That's wonderful. Well, so with that, obviously so much love going into all the disciplines that had a role in this, right? You're talking, you know, Kim, is that a Disney song that I'm hearing? so much work in terms of obviously animation for audio animatronics figures, in terms of audio, in terms of costume. There's so much new here, and yet your role was to make sure everyone was working in unison to deliver this on time, that the Bears were ready for their new act. So if you wouldn't mind, take us through what some of those kind of starring disciplines were and what they brought to the table.
Well, it starts with a great show writer, and we had John Kazlauskas on this, who came from Hollywood, and he used to write for shows and movies, and he's now an Imagineer, and he's put a lot of dad jokes in here. still the classic Bears and that hokiness, and then creative director Max Frederick came up with the original concepts, and then my job as a producer is to make that reality. So how do we do that? We bring in the best. Let's bring in Kevin Kidney and Jody Daly to do our concept design for our costumes, right? They're passionate about Disney. They've been involved with Disney, and they're great artists. And let's take those concepts and hand them over to Walt with normal costuming, but let's deliver those concepts as close as we can. And we spent weeks looking at materials and samples and colors. And these are some of the best audio-animatronic costumes you'll see. I have so many favorites. Romeo, for sure. His shirt is inspired by Romeo today. And Henry's coat. I wish I had Henry's coat because it's just amazing. And
so
Henry's coat did start off as blue, and it changed to cream just because it didn't work quite well with the curtains behind him. But Kevin and Jody kind of went back and revised their art for us.
And does anyone here know Kevin, Katie, and Jody Daly, know of their work? If you don't know of them, you know their work. They have been amazing designers for Disney since, oh goodness, decades. I think Kevin worked on the original Fantasmic for Disneyland.
Yeah, the original Dragon.
The original Dragon, yeah. Many of the parades and shows, both here in the U.S. and Tokyo Disney Resort, they're two of the biggest Country Bear fans I
know. And they have a merchandise line on Main Street, and they do a lot of work for Paris merchandise as well. So some other things we did was, I mentioned before, one of my main responsibilities is manager of technical show quality is refurbished on the animatronics. The bears were completely stripped down and rebuilt. All new hoses, bushings, bearings. New fur, new skin. So they've been completely refurbished. They're still hydraulic, but their control system was also updated to a modern control system. And what that does for them, through compliance, is allows them to be more fluid. So they're what's considered A1 audio animatronics. Now they're more of an A1, A100 audio animatronic hybrid. And if you don't know, the first A100 was the Wicked Witch in Great Movie Ride. She was the first one to have compliance. What compliance does is a typical A1 will just move their arm and look robotic. But compliance allows them to move more like a human through sensors. So if I move my arm, you see my torso moves. That's what the figures do now. So they're much more fluid and dynamic, and we can get a lot more range of motion out of them and a lot more life, you know. And so that was amazing. All new show lighting, new carpet, the benches have been touched up. The entire venue has been painted. By the way, that's not paint. That's all gold leaf from the Presidium, and that was all redone during the downtime. We had over 100 people working in here, practically tripping over each other, but with scaffolding. The curtains are all new. I tell you, just even curtains are a challenge because they have to be flame retardant. And if you were at Paris before, the audio didn't sound great. Part of the reason why was that having the lower curtain muffles the audio. So how do we fix that? So you'll notice the scallops are a little higher, but there's a secondary curtain balance in front of the speaker now that's acoustic rated that allows the audio to pass. And so that was a challenge. How do we find, you know, the right curtains? So there was a lot of work into detail. No stone was left unturned in this venue. Their eyes used to be stickers for the pupils. They're now new technology, and you can see that they glisten and add so much life to the figure just through the eyes and that warmth. The other thing we did is, I know there's, you know, there's people that love the clicking, but you didn't see it. You didn't see it today because the show is paused, but from the moment you walk in the door now, the heads greet you. They start cracking jokes. They tell you to move in. I think Melvin says, put your bear butt in the seat, and the guy's like, no, no, no. So the reason why we had to get rid of the clicking, and we did that through electric motors on their eyes and their eye blinks, is because without music, it's really too loud for you to hear that their dialogue over the clicking. They also sing a lot more and engage a lot more in the show, and you'll see that later on.
Well, going back to the animation of these figures, you know, I think they look fantastic. They have wonderful performances that everyone's going to get to see. And with that, I want to quickly talk to John, one of the great Imagineers who I consider truly legendary, who was one of the lead animators on this. And his name is Doug Griffith. And Ken, you were mentioning him. He started back in the Epcot era. He animated some of my favorite attractions, Journey to Imagination, American Adventure, The Risings, Kitchen Cabaret. He even did the 1992 version of the original show when it came back. And so the version of Country Bears I grew up with was Doug's work in many ways. Tell us about Doug and what he brought to this.
Doug's just phenomenal. He animated the Lasso in American Adventure. That's all Doug. He animated the Fighting Pirates in Disneyland Paris as Pirates of the Caribbean. And the Wicked Witch. He, in the great movie Red, that was originally his animation. He's been around for 30 plus years, and he's phenomenal. He came from the animation studio, so what better person to understand animating figures than a 2D animator? And he's a wizard on the old console. And I knew I had to have him on this project. I worked with Doug on updating the auction scene. I worked with him on Hall of Presidents for two updates. And I'm like, I want Doug. If this show is going to be the best, then I want Doug. And you'll see, just especially Ernest, the dude. You'll just see all these nuances in his eyes and his ears that just add so much character. Again, bringing that cartoon to life in the real world. And he's just phenomenal. And coincidentally, this is his last show, and he's going on a great note, because he is retiring at the end of this month. And it's, for me, it's a loss, because I really look up to Doug and appreciate how he animates figures.
I'm going to see a really good performance thanks to Doug and all these teams kind of you mentioned. So amazing disciplines at work here. Now let's talk about music for a little bit, because that's such a huge part of this, right?
Yeah, so again, I said earlier, we wanted lyrics that resonate with multiple generations and connect, but we really wanted to stay authentic country bears, right? So how do you do that? Well, you bring in the best. 10-time CMA Musician of the Year, Matt McAnally, who was phenomenal, huge country bear fan himself, to recompose the music, the bass music, in various country genres. And I tell you, I love some of these songs better than the originals. So, and I've been listening to them in the car, which, Disney nerd. And one of the other things, and then you bring in talent to sing those songs, like Emily Ann Roberts for Trixie. When we're looking at Trixie, we're like, she needs to be twangy, have that southern draw. My favorite quote from Emily that she said is, she's like, I'm as country as cornbread. I'm like, she's Trixie. And then, Chris Thiele, who's a world-renowned mandolin player, was perfect for Wendell, and Allison Russell, Grammy Award-winning Canadian folk artist, was perfect for Teddy. So Mac does Shaker as well. Let's talk about the song choices too. The songs they weren't chosen at random. They were all picked for a reason, because they work with the character. And so Trixie, for 50 years, she's been a failure. Now she's finally found what she's good at 50 years later. So try everything, it's her redemption song, So for Teddy Bear, it was very clear from way up there that whole new world worked for Teddy Bear, right? And I know the mandolin kind of fit with that. Sammy and Henry have been pals going back 50 years, so what better song than You've Got a Friend in Me? Because that's true. That rings with them. And Big Al, you need something slow and draw out, and do that. So remember, we worked for Big Al. And first,
it's not a spare belt tour.
And when I think of, we wanted to put, again, multi-generational, when we're looking at Frozen, I was like, we really don't want Elsa, we don't want Teddy and Elsa dressing Let It Go. We want to stay in the playing country. So when you think of Kristoff and Sven and that goofiness and that wackiness, that's the country bears. And that's why we picked for Shaker, that's why we picked Fixer Upper, I'm sorry. And have the heads, the deer, sing along with Shaker. That was like Sven and Kristoff. So every song was picked for a reason, and they were picked to go across multi-generations from the 70s through the 2000s. So the other thing you'll notice is, and this goes back to Mark Davis. He said, when you're doing songs for the bears, you want them to be short and quick. You do not want the guests to focus on the bears for long, because the longer you focus on the bear, the longer that illusion of life fades away, because they are just animatronics. So that's why some of those songs seem short, but that again goes back to Mark Davis. Could keep it quick, get those jokes out, and then move on to the next act.
Well, with that, as you're talking about these song choices and the musical artists, from Nashville, from across the country, I was thinking back to really the original development of the first Country Bear Jamboree, because there's so many parallels. George Bruns, Disney legend, musical director of the show, did Sleeping Beauty and the Enchanted Tiki Room, and obviously the original Country Bear Jamboree. But not just the Disney studio talent, but they went to Nashville, and they engaged in a group called the Stonemans. Does anyone here know the Stoneman family? they're a multi-generational family. The longest playing country family in Nashville. And they actually did many of the recordings over there in Tennessee. They had many of the Stoneman family members voice some of the bears. And so the fact that, you know, you went out there, you carefully selected these amazing singers, you know, you went to those recording sessions yourself and got to really bring that culture to life. And many decades later, you know, fresh, but also harkens back to the DNA of the original show. So with that, I was talking with you backstage, Dan, before the first show, and I told you a piece of information that I think you got pretty excited about when you heard it. You know, as archivists, we're always thrilled to find a piece of information that we had never seen before, that we never heard before. And that was certainly the case when we worked with our friends at the Disney Music Legacy Library, who maintained the musical history in many respects of our films, our TV shows, our park attractions, and we're doing research on the Country Bear Jamboree. So we pulled out the Country Bear Jamboree file. And how is Kevin over here somewhere? Is Kevin in the audience? Oh, hey, Kevin, you're over there. How's it going?
Just hanging around.
Okay. I think I see a parallel here. So I was talking about the Disney Music Legacy Library, Gina Cadente's group over in Burbank.
Amazing partners.
Right? And why don't you tell the audience the kind of amazing thing that you noticed about how long it took to kind of get that original song list together?
We got this amazing file. We start looking through it and we go, oh my gosh, how long did it take them to clear all of this music and store up all the rights and reach out to all the original performers? I think it was like, what, Steve, 14 months?
Yeah, 14 plus months.
14 plus months to get all that music for the first show ready to go.
Yeah, that was amazing. Thank you, Kevin.
You're welcome.
You should. See you later. Mm-hmm. Big round of applause for Kevin. Really amazing, Ken, was what we kind of like gasped at really was the very first note in the Country Bear file going back to November 11th, 1968 was the date of that note. It was from a gentleman who was head of the music department, sent a note over to the head of the audio animatronics programming team, Bob Jackson, to Neil Gallagher, those were your names. Amazing, amazing, amazing talents. And the memo says, here are the arrangements in snare drum, bass drum, and xylophone for Bear Band for the songs Hi-Ho, and Dibbidi-Bobbidi-Boo. So long before we actually had our final song list of these country western melodies, we were kind of dabbling in songs from our Disney films. That was a consideration that Mark and all these teams were aware of. So amazing that 50 plus years later, that initial idea, that kernel, manifests itself here, which I think is really exciting. So you and me, you and all of us. So. Now, Ken, you know, talk a little bit about the theater and everything that went into here, but let's talk a little bit about the lobby, because there's some great displays. Can you tell us the significance of the different displays, what you have in them?
Well, we wanted to start with bringing this show and the story out to the lobby, so we took a little page from the Tokyo Country Bear Jamboree and had prop cases, and each case has a different theme. Their travels around the world, their early years, their awards, and their, you know, making of the current show. Some of my favorites are the gal's vest. If you look from far away, it looks like Tour of the World, but when you get up close, it's Paris, Texas, and he never ends. He's on his 11th farewell tour, probably soon to be number 12. But one of my favorites is, we went through Mark Davis' art through the archives and looked at a lot of his original work. There's more of his work hanging in the lobby now, and you can see some of his jazz band renditions of the Bears. There's an original of Oscar with his teddy bear, and that's what we used for his fur styling this time around. But my favorite is the Growly Award in the awards case. And that was based on a Mark Davis art of a bear with a tuba around him. And I'm like, we have to make this into an award. And it's absolutely my favorite. Keep hinting at merchandise that I would buy one if they would make it. I haven't seen it yet.
And that is one of the sketches you believe that Mark showed Walt on that day he visited, so that's very special. There's also a medal in there that has a bear with a honeycomb. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so in Walt's office, which is still out there in California for people to tour if they're out there, he's got several coins from the Berlin or Berlin Film Festival, and we wanted to make our own music award for the Bears to tie back to those awards in Walt's office. So that's where that coin comes from.
Another Walt Disney connection. So, yeah, that's wonderful. So, with that, as we sort of prepare ourselves in just a couple moments to enjoy the brand new Country Bear Musical Jamboree, a couple wrap-up questions. Kind of fire around. Any favorite Easter eggs you want to share with the audience?
Well, we do mention Mineral Springs. you'll definitely find a neat scene and some connection back to the original DNA of the original show. You want to keep that. Lots of dad jokes galore. My favorite, because I live it every day, is during the fiddle scene with Curtis smoking Melvin and Max makes some jokes.
He's not smoking, he's
fiddle smoking. Yeah. Melvin and Max make some jokes about he's on fire today, yeah, he's really smoking, and Buff chimes in with, yeah, he's really burning through our fiddle budget. And he's like, I can't believe we have a fiddle budget. I'm like, I feel like that's my job.
Okay, I have a question I didn't plan to ask you, but I know at Imagineering, you cannot confirm or deny the existence of hidden Mickeys. However, if we were to see a hidden Mickey, is that something that, in theory, one could see?
I can neither confirm nor deny that, but I would definitely check back after Wednesday if you wanted to start looking.
And after the official opening of the show, we might find them. You're giving them a reason to come back,
but I didn't say that.
Okay. Off the record, just for D23 members. And then finally, so many great characters, so many great moments. Who is your favorite country bear?
Henry. Once again, I want that coat. Henry and I relate. This show's kind of like a mess, chaos, but it's hokey and it's funny. And I feel like that's what my world was for the past year, working on the project with over 100 people in here and scaffolding and tripping over each other and just having fun putting the show together. So I can relate to him.
That's wonderful. Well, no better person to lead it. Thank you, Ken. Big round of applause for Ken. Thank you.
Instead of talking about it, let them see the show.
All right, sounds good. Enjoy the show and have a wonderful evening afterwards. Take care.
So now's the time we remind you there's no eating, drinking, or smoking allowed in the theater. And you can take all the photos and video you'd like, just please, no flash photography or video lighting. We've already got Rufus on spotlight.
Do we? Psst, Rufus, wake up! Oh. Over here. Sorry.
Okay, everybody, now we're ready to start. Give us a little intro there, Gomer. Howdy, folks. Welcome to the one and only original Country Bear musical tambourine, featuring a wild and woolly assortment of grizzled old grizzlies singing a little country, a little western, and a whole lot of everything in between. So get those paws tapping and those claws clapping for five bears who need no introduction, but I'll give them one anyway. Let's hear it for the Five Bear Rocks! Yeah! It's a country band musical tambourine. He's rapping, so tapping to the lead.
Musical jamboree.
That's pretty good.
our very own Trixie and the talented trio, Bunny, Bubbles, and Beulah. Or is it Beulah, Bunny, and Bubbles? Well, any way you count it, they're triple the fun.
Scared of heights.
I'm scared of swings.
You know, it might surprise you to learn that our next performer is still an eligible bachelor.
Is it the clumpy way he walks?
Or the grumpy way he talks? Or the pear-shaped, square-shaped weirdness of his feet?
And though we know he washes well,
he always ends up sort of smelly.
But you'll never meet a fella who's as sensitive as me. Everyone's a bit of a fixer-upper, that's what it's all about.
Father, sister,
we need each other to raise us up and round us out. Everyone's a bit of a fixer-upper, but when push comes to shove, the only fixer or fixer that'll fix a fixer-upper is true.
You say, Sammy?
I say, y'all come back, yeah?